Okay, hey, good morning, everyone. First, I'd like to thank the Linux Foundation events team, Angela and crew. I've been speaking at Linux Foundation events for many, many years, and you know, it just keeps getting better, you know. So just hands for Angela and her team for an amazing job. Thanks, Angela. Okay, so every time I speak, it's really an honor for me to be, I manage a large group of open source engineers at Intel, Linux and systems and open source engineers, and it's really an honor for me, and I'm always thrilled to speak on behalf of those engineers, because all I'm really doing is just, I'm gonna be talking about some of the coolest projects that that they're working on, and I'll talk a little bit about what they're up to these days. So, so with that, you know, let me start with a little bit on what is guiding our vision in a lot of these projects that I'm going to talk about. So, so everybody here is very familiar with software-defined infrastructure in the data center. You know, software-defined compute, orchestration, software-defined storage, networking, great success. And this, by the way, would not have been a success without the amazing open source projects. I mean, literally, I don't know who made the comment about open source made the cloud. That's absolutely true. It is Kubernetes, it is Linux, it's KVM, it's all of these projects that made, you know, the software defined data center, the dynamic self-service, the data center made that possible. So we believe that that the future is software-defined everything. And by that, we mean that things like industrial automation, factories, cars, planes, turbines, all of these things are at some point will move slowly to be software-defined. And there are a lot of advantages to that. And we also believe that just like what happened in the cloud, the same thing will happen in all of these software-defined segments and usages. And that is, open source will lead the way in making this almost revolution happen in compute and in all of these usages. You will hear me talk or mention Clear Linux as I talk through a lot of projects. So a lot of you are probably familiar with it. I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes talking about the Clear Linux projects just to make sure that, you know, as I refer to it, people just know what I'm talking about. So Clear Linux project is a Linux distribution that is developed by Intel. And there is nothing new about Intel developing operating systems. I mean, we've created Yocto, we've created Zephyr, we've created a bunch of other distributions, Linux and other open source distributions. But what's different about Clear Linux is a project which we started about 5 years ago, is it is really catering to the modern usages of cloud, of software-defined, modern usages in IoT and in tethered devices in general. So going beyond the traditional embedded and the traditional data center. So this is where we do the work for things like functional safety, adding the functional safety capabilities, which I'll talk about a little bit more, about how do we utilize the hardware, you know, how we evolved it to a super, super fast cadence of a Linux distribution in days. And our purpose is really for everybody to be able to take from this distribution and steal with pride. Please do just take whatever you want from, and we will help you do that. And whether it's features or take it as is, you know, we want you to actually use that. So the key conclusion that we came to, especially over the past couple of years, is that for this to be usable by others, we need to develop it as a product quality distribution so that whatever code comes out of it is product quality. Okay, so with that, let me talk about one of the first things that we've been working on for quite some time, and that is safety critical systems. So safety critical systems, as I said, we believe that a lot of these industries, whether it's cars or medical devices or industrial automation, will migrate to being software defined. Well, that brings in a new problem that we did not necessarily have in cloud and in data center, and that is the safety criticality or the functional safety of an operating system. Because with this kind of a usage, you have things like that are truly functionally safe. And by that, by the way, what it means is that there is some kind of an injury or something bad, really, really bad will happen in the path of functionally safe. And there are things that it's okay, you know, if things bad happen. So to give you an example, if there is a latency in your video, that's kind of okay. It's annoying, but it's okay. But if there is a latency in your braking system, you could die. So with a software-defined system that would use something similar to this, it's really important to figure out, okay, what is all the safety critical? How do you make something that is open source safety critical? So the industry over the past 20 years figured out how to do safety critical through microcontroller systems. So it would be microcontroller, that's a safety critical, then the rest of the system is not microcontroller. So right now we're saying that, hey, this is going to be software defined, and you have to be accommodating both. So you probably heard me talk about the Intel safety critical projects that we've been working on probably for a couple of years now. We talked about it a little bit. It's been worked mostly internally, and this is, the key thing to understand about, and we started it, by the way, with the hypervisor part. This is the Acorn hypervisor that we launched with the Linux Foundation a few months ago, and now we're moving into the OS, which is the big piece, if you will, that will create the entire environment to be able to run a functionally safe OS. So the key aspect of this is that it's not so much about code, it's all the components and all the argumentation that is intended to make somebody create a functionally safe system. And that is really, really hard work. And without this, you will not be able to have a fully software-defined, whether it's a software-defined car or software-defined anything. So this is a hard problem, and this is where we really invite you to start participating in our safety projects on CLEAR. So, and you will hear us talk a lot about much more about this. Now, a second problem that we've been facing, and all of our, Intel customers and partners and quite a few people from the community is when we have these discussions around, hey, Intel is doing this feature in hardware, or there is this feature in hardware, forget Intel. And the problem that we're beginning to see, given the complexity of the features, is that nobody sees any benefit from those features. Not really, unless you are a company and you build an entire vertical solution, that's when you start seeing a benefit. So we did this experiment with what is called an AVX. AVX is an instruction set that is that's advanced vector extensions in Intel CPUs. So what these instructions do is allows you to do math like really quickly in very, very few instructions. So intuitively, you'd think that something like deep learning, where you're doing a lot of math, a lot of matrix multiplications and matrix manipulations, you'd think that, oh my God, AVX would be like make it scream. The reality is, so some of the kernel enabling and some of the various components, work was done for AVX and various components, and nothing happened. There was no improvement. So what we ended up doing is taking a look at the entire stack, what we call like a deep learning as a service, and every single component, top to bottom, and then we went through every single one of them and able just utilize the hardware for that purpose. And you know what happened? Over 7% performance improvement. This is not a 20% performance improvement or 15%. This is over 7x performance improvement when you utilize and you look at a use case, top to bottom. The same thing we did with Apache Spark, same results, 8x performance improvement. So that got us to thinking and creating, these use cases that we are trying, that is built on a common, that everybody agrees to, a common infrastructure as a service with, basically Linux, Kubernetes, KVM. So everybody agrees to the basic infrastructure as a service stack, and then build use cases on that. And we're still, much of that work happening internally. Obviously we'll bring that out and we'll make it available. But this is what really excites us about this. And it's not only about use cases when it's performance, when you really take into consideration of using the hardware correctly. These are just a bunch of benchmarks from Foronix. These are public benchmarks, you can take a look at them. So one of the things that we do in Clear Linux, and we encourage everybody who's using Linux to do, is to be aware of what the hardware can do for you. So in this case, in Clear Linux, just some of the latest benchmarking, you have something like the R language. That is, 4x better. Some TensorFlow, 2x better. So when you use the hardware in those cases, you actually get a real benefit from utilizing the hardware properly. And so please go ahead and take a look at Clear and what we are doing there, and steal with pride. Now I'm going to switch topics and talk about application isolation and isolation in general. So. Some of it you're aware of. I'll just like to be the ad for our engineers, and this is around what we've done with Kata containers. The choice that we were faced with, or container partners, or container users were faced with, is that you had, on the one hand, containers. Great. They're very fast. They're very simple to use. And on the other extreme, you have full virtual machines, which very, very secure, but slow. So you had the choice of speed or security, and what we really wanted was speed and security. So this is what we developed Intel, the Clear containers, which we eventually, working with, Huawei and Microsoft and Google and a whole bunch of us got together and created this merge of a project that's on that same concept, that is Kata containers, that is containers in the sense that they are, they're compliant with OCI, it integrates with all the cloud infrastructure and so on. And what that got us to think is about virtualization technology. So virtualization is very, very old, as all of us know. It's wonderful, it's the basis of much of the data centers today, but also it's stale. It's stale in that it hasn't grown. It is, it's slow. It's, it still supports floppy disks. And I don't think there's a lot of floppy disks in data centers. So we started taking a look at that. And a new project emerged that really separates the emulation from virtualization. And it completely, and by the way, like code size goes down dramatically, very, very dramatically. Complexity goes down dramatically. Performance, significantly much better. And this is basically defining a free PC legacy, virtualization infrastructure, all KVM, and really moving that forward. So this is just getting started. The project is on GitHub. Feel free to, it's a GitHub Intel new EMU. So please do feel free to take a look at it. It's probably one of the most exciting projects that we're seeing today. So, and finally on application isolation, I wouldn't, this talk would be missing, given that I spoke at about functional safety, without talking about the functionally safe hypervisor, because that is what is the underlying foundation of software-defined infrastructure outside of the cloud, as I talked in factories, cars, and so on. So 25,000 lines of code hypervisor that is functionally safe capable with all the capabilities that is designed specifically for that purpose. So much of our work we're bringing to now extending to a lot of other projects. So you can hear all about this, and you know, there's a bunch of sessions. Probably one session I do encourage all of you to go to is the Aineta session on Clear Linux. It's at 4 o'clock today. And in our booth, you know, plenty, you know, we're talking, you know, about all of these projects, Acorn, Clear Linux, and Kata, and whatever other things you'd like to talk about, we're there to talk to you. So thank you very much, and have a good rest of summit.